Assalamu alaikum.
I'm going to shift to English, unfortunately. Ladies and gentlemen, colleagues, really a pleasure to be here today for the second Qatar Foundation Research Forum. I was here last year, actually, and I can tell you there's been already a lot of palatable progress, not only in the venue, which is quite impressive here, but more importantly in the science. I spent yesterday as part of a jury listening to scientists presenting their work in biomedicine, and I think there's really great talent and good science going on, so congratulations on that. As I was thinking about what I would be telling this audience today, I decided maybe I should tell you about how a large pharmaceutical company struggles to achieve its financial performance in today's very demanding economy, and whether this allows it to, at the same time, commit to its social responsibility of advancing global health for all patients throughout the world, whether in the Western developed world or in the least developed countries, and also whether it still has the opportunity to share its knowledge and its know-how to advance public health. So my presentation is going to be in three parts. I'm going to first tell you a little bit about the pharmaceutical industry's situation, and in particular that of GlaxoSmithKline, the company I chair R&D for, and I'm a board member of that company. But also, as a second part, I'll tell you what we have done over the past 5 to 6 years to advance our performance as a company, and in particular as an R&D organization. I think that's pertinent to what you're trying to do. And in the third part of my presentation, I will shift gears and share with you two examples of our efforts to advance global health in areas where financial return is not the driver of our work. So I hope I can make this thing work. So if you look at the pharmaceutical industry in general, and GlaxoSmithKline in particular, you will realize very quickly we are in a very tough situation. This slide actually shows the percentage of global sales of our companies, many pharma companies you recognize there, that were at risk of becoming generic medicines and therefore lost sales for the pharma company between the years 2005 and 2010. And you can see that some companies like Pfizer are losing more than half of their sales in a period of 5 years. That represents several billion dollars. For GSK, that represented about 40% of our sales, or £6 billion, which is about $10 billion lost to generics, primarily, but also to healthcare reform in the US and an issue we had with one of our medicines for diabetes that you probably know, Avandia. For a company to survive losing $10 billion of sales in a period of 4 or 5 years is a tremendous challenge. And in the pharmaceutical industry, the engine we have to renew our sales and keep ourselves going are new medicines that are coming out of research and development. The only problem for the pharma industry is that research and development productivity has been really dwindling over the last few years. On this graph, what you could see is from the year 1950 through now, the cost and output of R&D from pharmaceutical companies. And you can see that in 1950, when you invested $1 billion, you had almost 30 medicines coming out of that. Today, to have one medicine approved, it takes between $1.8 and $2 billion. That's an enormous decrease in productivity and also an enormous increase in cost of R&D. And therefore, this engine that's supposed to renew so many sales is not running right, and it was imperative that we change it. In fact, just as lately as March of this year, one of the major analysts in one of the major investors, Bernstein, has published a work showing that the 9 largest pharmaceutical companies in the world are investing every year about $60 billion in R&D. And that if they wanted only a 10% return on that investment should be producing $100 billion in new sales by the year 2021 and beyond every year. I can tell you that's just impossible. And there's actually no public health budget that would be able to support such an expense, even if we made the medicines. So the pharmaceutical industry analysts have concluded, and frankly leaders of the pharma industry have concluded, is going to have to shrink. Companies may disappear, companies may merge, but also to shrink its R&D. And you could see on the slide here, they even proposed that every 20% reduction in R&D budget will actually provide a 10% increase in profit. And many companies have seen their share value go up because they decided to close many of their R&D activities. This is a real threat to public health if you project it in the long term, because if we don't invest in R&D, we are not going to be able to advance new medicines. And this is a real threat to the commitment of large companies to global health, to the health of those who are most in need of it in sub-Saharan Africa, in some regions in Latin America or Southeastern Asia. And therefore, the commitment to global health is really put at risk by the current financial situation and economic situation of the pharmaceutical industry. So I'm now going to tell you what GSK did about this. What we did in a nutshell was to say, let's take advantage of the fact that we are a diversified corporation that makes medicines through our pharmaceutical organization, but also makes vaccines and also make consumer health medicine. And let's also take advantage of the fact that we are present in 142 countries in the world to try and grow our sales through vaccines, through consumer health, through expansion in what we call EMAP, which is emerging markets, Asia and Pacific, while we are reigniting, if you wish, our R&D engine. Let's try to not, you know, collapse because we're losing $10 billion in sales. Let's try to find them somewhere else. And in the meantime, re-engineer our R&D engine. And in doing that, let's also rebuild the trust between us and society. Because as you know, it's actually quite dramatic that the reputation of pharmaceutical companies is only second in the lower part of the scale to that of tobacco companies, which is, I think, pathetic and really very bad. So what have we done? This slide shows you our sales in 2006 and 2010. And in fact, what it shows is our presence in the West, in Europe and in the US, has significantly decreased. And our presence in the emerging markets, our presence with consumer health products, and our presence with vaccines, which, as you know, are the most impactful public health intervention, has dramatically increased. And fortunately, over the past 4 years, we've been able actually to still grow this company despite the loss of $10 billion in sales, which is an enormous, frankly, accomplishment. And this has allowed us to have 4 or 5 years of time during which we could redesign our R&D engine and see whether we can make it more productive. And that's what I'm going to be telling you about. This slide shows you actually in what position we are now. Today, this is the same slide as the one I showed you, the first slide I showed you with some data on it, which is the percentage of sales at risk to generalization between 2010 and 2015. And you can see that GSK doesn't have any sales at risk of generalization. In other words, if our R&D engine is now able to make new medicines, this will be a great opportunity for GSK to grow when other companies are really going to be at very, very high risk. So we are reasonably satisfied with this situation as a corporation. And now it's key for us to have a productive R&D engine. So let's take you through what we've done over the past 5.5 years to turn around the productivity of R&D. I'm going to be reasonably brief, and if there is a Q&A question, I'll be happy to address your questions. What we decided to start with is to set ourselves very clear and measurable objectives. So in 2006, we decided that we are going to double the output of our R&D organization using the same resources as the resources we had in 2006. We decided that we will be able to produce, or we should be able to produce, between 5 and 7 new medicines every year. Now, you need to know this is a very challenging objective, because between 1999 and 2006, GSK produced 2 new medicines in 8 years. We're going to start to produce between 5 and 7 per year. We also committed to the financial world, to the street, to have a return on invested money in R&D of about 14%. What you need to know is currently the average return on R&D in the pharmaceutical industry is anywhere between 5 and 8%. So again, a very significant increase, but importantly, a commitment to a number that we will deliver. How did we go about it? Well, we identified four key principles and a fifth important feature that I talked about a little bit during the panel discussion 2 days ago. The four key principles that we used are actually quite straightforward, but I will expand on them in a minute. It's focus on the best science, repersonalize R&D, diversify through externalization, and focus on return on investment. And the fifth and probably most important feature that we worked very hard and we continue to work on is to change the culture of the organization, to move from a culture where everything is expected and budget is supposed to be spent to a culture based on empowerment, on accountability, on drive and ownership of the decision we make, and based on return on investment in R&D. So you shouldn't expect to get any money unless you have a good idea that deserves to be invested into. But 5 years later, I'll just go quickly to this slide and tell you more. I think we have turned the corner. We totally transformed our discovery organization. We totally changed our development organization. We were not present in biopharmaceuticals, large molecules, 6 years ago. We now have about 20% of our pipeline coming from biopharmaceuticals. We have the largest oncology pipeline in the industry today. And we have invested a lot, as I said, in our cultural change. So a little bit more flavor on what we've done. What we have done on the first principle of focusing on the best science is the following. 5 years ago, 10 years ago, actually yesterday I was talking with Rick Klausner and he's telling me about another pharma company. The way pharma companies used to invest in R&D was to say, I'm very big in, let's say, lung diseases, in asthma, and therefore I'm going to invest a lot of money in R&D to stay big in asthma. The little problem we had is if there was no new science in asthma, there was no way we would invent and discover a new medicine for asthma because there is no new science to discover it. So we turned upside down the principles of investment in R&D and decided we're not going to decide to invest because we want to be big in asthma or in diabetes or in oncology. No. What we're going to do is look at the science, the basic science in biomedicine, and see where is the science ripe to discover new medicines. And those are the areas we should invest into. If they happen to be areas where we're big, fine. If there are areas we're not big into and we need to access new expertise, that's what we should do, because science is what allows discovery of new medicines. We spent a year, 4.5 years ago, reviewing 17 different therapeutic areas, involving more than 1,000 of our 16,000 scientists in the company and several hundred external experts. And we mapped where is the exciting science. And we decided to exit some areas in which we were very big because there is no new science, like gastrointestinal, like some aspects of cardiovascular and some aspect of neurosciences. And we decided to invest in some area where there was nascent great new science, like immunoinflammation or a number of rare diseases and others. In the process of doing that, we also identified those individuals in our organization that were really bright scientists, because the second principle on which we based the re-engineering of R&D was to negate what we did in the previous 10 or 15 years, which was to make process the master of R&D. What the pharmaceutical industry did in the past was to say, there is a process through which we discover medicines. As long as you take a project through the process, something is going to come on the other side of it. And we used the natural attrition as an excuse to our failures. Well, of course, you have to take a project through a process from discovery to development. But the key is you need to have insight. You need to have expertise. You need to have knowledge. You need to have what I call educated intuition. You need to, more often than not, predict accurately that something may lead to a medicine. And it's not easy. I actually believe discovering a new medicine and make it available to patients is actually harder than taking a man on the moon, because we know the moon exists, we know a rocket can fly. It's a very hard task, but you know it's feasible. Making a new medicine against diabetes, you just don't know. But that's not an excuse to just use a process. You should use insight. So what we did was put back the individual, and that's what we call repersonalizing R&D. We put back the individual at the helm in making decisions, and the right individuals. So as I said, during the 17 therapeutic area reviews, we identified the best talent we had. Sometimes they were from the company, sometimes they were not from the company. We attracted them and brought them into the company and trusted them and empowered them, but also held them accountable to drive discovery. And we organized them in very small teams. Our teams now are called Discovery Performance Unit. They have between 10 and 60 maximum scientists into them. Before, you were one scientist in 5,000. You could sleep the whole day, nobody cared. Or you could work very hard the whole day and nobody cared either, because you're one in 5,000. Now they're all very small teams, they're organized like small biotech companies. We invest in them, we review them every 3 years, and they either deliver, and that's great, or then they don't deliver, and then we don't invest in them anymore. And that has dramatically changed the output of our discovery organization. We did the same thing with our late-stage programs. You know, when you discover a medicine and you have early events in the clinic that tells you this could be a successful program, you invest more heavily in the project. It's called late-stage development, take it into phase two and phase three trials. And we organize the team that drive those projects as small corporations with a CEO called the medicine development leader, and they have 6 to 8 members in it. And they have a plan and they deliver on the plan. And again, they're held accountable. Today we have 38 discovery performance units. We have 33 medicine development teams. And we have, you know, almost 80 decision makers in R&D. That's key. 6, 7 years ago, we had one decision maker in R&D. If that person is right, fine. If that person is wrong, the corporation collapses. That's impossible. Diversity of thinking is key, and you cannot have insight in every single therapeutic area. A company like GSK covers almost every therapeutic area. The third key principle that we pursued in re-engineering R&D was to what I call diversify through externalization. The principle was the following. We had 16,000 scientists in our organization. There is more than 1 million scientists in biomedicine in the world. Our scientists are as good as any scientist outside in the world. And therefore, we're going to have, if you make the calculation, 1.5% of good ideas in the world. 98.5% of good ideas will happen outside of us. There's no reason we would have all the good ideas. So what we should do is be as cutting-edge science to be able to identify those teams that have good ideas outside in the world. And good ideas happen anywhere. They happen in Boston, they happen in Shanghai, they could happen here in Doha, they could happen in Argentina, anywhere in the world. So we embarked on a process to what we call externalize R&D, which is not contracting. We're not telling others what to do. We're learning from others what their idea is when we think they have a good idea and they have a good team with good leadership. And we invest into them. And we have now more than 50 strategic partners that help us build our pipeline. This, by the way, also helps us drive R&D without building infrastructure, because unfortunately, a number of ideas collapse, as you know. And the fourth principle is what I call return on investment, is to remind the organization is nobody is entitled to money to be spent on R&D. It's an investment, and there is an expectation of return. Many companies have built enormous facilities. We have facilities in more than 10 different countries doing R&D. It's too much. It's too expensive. And on January 1st of every year, you already spend 2/3 of your budget because you have to keep your facilities going and depreciate them and amortize them. We'd rather invest in projects because that's why we come. We come to make a medicine, not to build a facility. We have made very, very hard decisions around our organization. I will show you that. But also, we have changed the way we decide to progress programs. We no more advance a program in late-stage development because it's somebody's favorite program. We have an investment board that look in discovery and in development and uses a very stringent and harsh criteria before we invest. And unless there is a clear reason to believe this is going to progress, we don't invest into it. The outcome of this is here. Maybe before that, just a little slide to show you what we've done in terms of investment. I'll give you the actual numbers. Our budget in 2006 was for R&D was 3.2 billion pounds. That's about $5.5 billion per year. Our budget now is 2.8 billion pounds. So that's about 400 million pounds less. And it's not adjusted for inflation. So in real term, this is probably 800 million pounds less. We unfortunately let go 6,000 of our scientists. We now have about 10,000 scientists. We closed 45% of our square meter facilities because we didn't need them. But we dramatically increased our investment in projects. And you can see we more than doubled our late-stage pipeline. And I'll show you some statistics. For the past 3 years, we've had the largest number of new medicines approved. 13 new medicines have been approved in the past 3 years for GSK. Larger number than any other company. We also have the highest value pipeline into the industry. 7 years ago, we had no value in our pipeline. In fact, between January 1st, 2011 and December 31st, 2012, in a period of 24 months, we are having 35 phase 3 trials reading out, all recruited and ongoing. In 2006, we had 8 phase 3 trials. So that's more than 4 times more. You can see the bar where we are today, 16 phase 3 trials read out. The overwhelming majority is positive. Can you hear me? We feel that we are on the right track to have totally turned around R&D productivity in GSK. And hopefully, we can now, as I showed you in the slide earlier, drive, again, great growth in a company like GSK because we no more have the headwinds of patent expiries and generic erosion of our sales. Now, what did we do about our commitment to global health and our social responsibility for patients during this period of time where we were cutting our R&D budgets and dramatically improving our productivity? Did we abandon our mission, or did we still, in parallel, continue our commitment to patients? We did actually continue our commitment to patients. I'm going to share with you 2 examples. First one is our development of a malaria vaccine. This is a program that has been going on at GSK for 27 years. For 23 years, I participated in the program. Malaria is a dramatic disease in the world. It kills about 800,000 children every year. 800,000 every year in sub-Saharan Africa. There are some interventions, but none is really dramatically impactful. The best of intervention today are net beds that protect if there is adherence to them, meaning every evening you have to cover yourself with a net bed. There's about 30% protection against malaria. There is a dramatic need for a vaccine, and a vaccine is very hard to do because malaria, as you know, is a parasite, and today there is no human vaccine against a parasite. Malaria is a very, very complex parasite. It's a parasite that's transmitted by mosquitoes when they bite an individual, and they inject a first form of the parasite called sporozoite that spends a few hours, actually a few minutes, in our bloodstream and goes immediately in our liver, infects our hepatocytes, and for about 5 days, they transform themselves from that first stage called sporozoite stage to a second stage that's called merozoites. They burst out of the hepatocytes and infect our blood cells. When they infect our blood cells and kill them, that provokes the fevers and chills that are characteristic of malaria and that potentially can lead to cardiovascular accidents as well as death. But also a small fraction of these merozoites that infect blood cells transform themselves into a third stage called gametocyte that stay in our blood until a mosquito comes and bites us again. They get into the mosquito and then the cycle starts again. The strategy we pursued to design a vaccine against malaria was the following, was to take the parasite and target it into two different places. On the one hand, during the few minutes the parasite travels from the bite site to the liver with antibodies, because antibodies can kill the parasite, albeit in a very short period of time. And nobody succeeded to have protection with just that. And then as a secondary defense mechanism, to use a different arm of the immune system, cell-mediated immunity, and kill the parasite once it has infected our hepatocytes, before it bursts into merozoites, infect blood cells. And therefore, if we achieve that, we're going to prevent disease, right? You may get infected, but you don't get sick. And that's very important. So what we did was to identify an antigen on the sporozoite called circumsporozoite protein and design it in such a way as to be able to induce both antibodies and cell-mediated immunity. Don't go into the detail here, but trust me, it took us a lot of work, as I said, 27 years, to design an antigen in a form that will be both able to induce high antibody titers and cell-mediated immunity, and also to use what is called an adjuvant, adjuvant system number one as written there, that are components that we add to the vaccine and help us induce effective cell-mediated immunity. In this particular case, both cytotoxic T cells and gamma interferon secreting T cells. And we took this vaccine since the mid-90s into a large number of clinical trials, from patient challenge studies all the way through a large phase 3 trial. And we have just recently announced the results of our very large phase 3 trial involving about 17,000 infants in sub-Saharan Africa in more than 11 investigator sites in 7 countries. And this has been an enormous partnership with a very large number of collaborators, both from the West and from emerging countries. And of course, with a great partnership with the Gates Foundation and the Malaria Vaccine Initiative. Huge team effort that has just recently come to fruition. So as I said, we run a very large phase 3 trial in about 17,000 children. The trial had 3 groups into it, a group of infants, 6 to 12 weeks old, immunized with the vaccine, a second group of 5 to 17 months old children or toddlers immunized with the vaccine, and a third control group immunized with the control group. And the endpoint that we have really reached at this moment, this is a first analysis of the study, is the efficacy in the 5 to 17 months old children at 12 months. So at completion of the 3 immunization and a few more months beyond. And the data are on this slide. We were very pleased to see more than 50% efficacy against malaria and about 50% efficacy against severe malaria. Let me translate to you what those numbers mean, because 50% can appear as small. In the trial, for every 1,000 children in the trial, there were 1,500 cases of malaria, meaning on average, every child had 1.5 cases of malaria, because you can have repeated infection over a period of a year. In the control group, there were 1,500 cases of malaria for every 1,000 children. In the vaccine group, there were 700 cases of malaria per 1,000 children. So we spared 800 cases of malaria per 1,000 children per year. That's an enormous number. When you know that 25% of the health budget of sub-Saharan African countries is spent in hospital taking care of children with malaria, this could actually decrease that to 12% or 10% and literally transform investment in public health in Africa. The trial is continuing, as you saw. We have a 3 years follow-up into the trial. We have a second cohort of infants, 6 to 12 weeks old, but we are very, very encouraged that this could be a transforming event for public health in the world. This vaccine has never been an investment for a return, a financial return for GSK. Our commitment is to make it available at cost for the countries who need it and to engage partners like Gates, like Malaria Vaccine Initiative, like others, to help us make it available for patients who need it. We didn't stop there. Over the same period of time, we have actually enhanced our investment in an R&D center dedicated to what we call disease of developing world. That's what DDW stands for. We have actually a center that's focused on discovering medicines for malaria, leishmania, and a number of other neglected diseases, as they are called. It's a center that's focused on partnership and have recently been open as an open lab facility where we would more than welcome housing you if you have good ideas. That's the center. It's located in Tres Cantos, which is just outside of Madrid in Spain. It has about 120 scientists in it, and you can see some statistic there. And it has, in fact, all the might, if you wish, of GSK R&D that allows to not only have a good idea and a nice publication in Nature or PNAS, but actually have a medicine, which, trust me, is a very different process than a scientific publication. We have a very large number of partnership with organizations, non-government organizations, that are committed to helping public health and helping global health. And as I said, we have dedicated this center to become an open lab facility. What we've done, in fact, is made three decisions. We said, first, we're going to make all our intellectual property, all of it, that GSK had, available to whoever needs it to discover a medicine or a vaccine against a neglected disease for use in those countries that are the least developed countries that cannot pay for it. We will just make our patents available. A. B. We will make half of our facilities in Tres Cantos, outside of Madrid, available to scientists who have an idea. They can use our patents, they can use our facilities, they can use our chemical libraries, they can use all our animal models, if they have a good idea. And we created a fund that provides grants for those scientists when they have a good idea. And the fund is managed by an advisory board that is actually mainly populated with great experts that are not GSK leaders. So that's our commitment to public health. And we published actually the structure of all 1,300 malaria-specific compounds that we have in our chemical library. As you know, it was published in Nature a few months ago. And this is how we translate our commitment to public health. So in conclusion, I'd like to thank you and hopefully leave you with the facts that demonstrate that financial success and commitment to public health and global health and sharing of knowledge and information are actually compatible. In fact, as a board member of GSK, I'm very proud to say we're a company that focuses first on patients and then on shareholders, and there is no contradiction. In fact, when you really focus on patients, your shareholders are happy. Thank you. Is that Q&A? I have no idea whether there is a Q&A or not. There's a question there and a question there.
Giving us the challenges facing pharma and how they approach that and the GSK approach. And I think from what I see with reduced budget, reduced resources, and you presented the similar formula where every company is adopting, where you're talking about multiple indications per year, not new chemical entities per year, and you're talking about biopharmaceutical and oncology. And I see that driven by commercial, because biopharmaceutical command more pricing and oncology are easier to be approved by FDA. Can you comment on how the developing world or the countries outside the US and Europe are going to pay for biopharmaceutical, which costs several thousand per patient versus few hundred for small molecule?
Thanks for that question. And actually, we have a commitment. For the 50 least developed countries in the world, we will make our medicines available at cost plus 5%, and we will reinvest the 5% in R&D for diseases relevant to the least developed countries. It's actually a mistake to think that biopharmaceutical costs a fortune. It depends how much of that you make. If you actually produce them in very, very, very large quantities for the world, the per unit cost is less. and you can make a better return in those countries that can afford more, so that you can allow for them to be priced in a way that's available to patients or accessible to patients in those who can pay less. And this concept of tier pricing is, of course, critically important and is the way the Western countries are, in fact, indirectly helping the least developed country patients to access medicine, because it is a critical. Now, this is not why we invested in biopharma or in oncology. The reason we invested in them is the science is ripe to discover medicines.
Okay, I think I will maybe start the question.
Yes, Daniel Cohen from Pharnext in France. First, I'd like to congratulate you about the way you presented and the modest vision you have to say, do we have a problem in this field? And I think the way you take to reorganize the R&D in the big structure is fantastic and show it is very good. Many scientists think, however, the decline in pipeline is also due to biological problem, not only to an organizational problem. Like the complexity, the biological complexity has been a little bit neglected in our approach. So when you say, and it is very impressive that you have increased by 2 or 3 the number of phase 3, can I ask you how many really new innovative drugs you have among these? These are me too's or really drugs treating unmet medical needs?
Yeah, it's a great question. And so two levels to the answer. First, it takes between 10 and 15 years for an idea to go from idea to a medicine, right? So our phase three, and the phase three programs for the late stage development takes 5-7 years. So in the past 5 years, the new ideas we started from scratch are just getting to the clinic. If I look there, 100% of our plan are novel mechanisms. If I look into our late-stage pipeline, I would say we have three totally innovative first-in-class medicines. The rest are new medicines, but competitive in the world. Not approved already. Actually, that I can think of, only one is an approved mechanism already, GLP-1. But others are more advanced than us in that race. But, you know, like BRAF and MEK inhibitors are completely new. We have a phospholipase inhibitor for cardiovascular disease that's first and only in class. That's also in very large phase 3 trials.
Okay. Thank you.
I have a question on this side.
There's a question here?
Yeah.
Okay, question there and then a question here. Okay. If you can bring the microphone here, please.
Okay. Thank you very much and really enlightening lecture and congratulations on really reinventing the process of R&D within pharmaceuticals. It's very impressive what you presented. And the question I have is, the essence of what of the model that you presented really builds on focusing on best science. And the question, and moving that process of defining the best science, maybe from the pharmaceutical companies to the maybe universities and other institutions that does that science, which is mostly actually research that's being funded by public entities, by governments and so on. And so, I mean, given your presentation, I would think it's natural to expect that there would be a movement by other companies to follow your lead, given the amount, the degree of success that you showed. So what do you think would make this new model sustainable if really the main reliance on it is really on funding that comes from basically the public sector? Do you think that maybe for its success there would be a new responsibility for pharmaceuticals to maybe try and invest or help the process of research that's really now the main part of it is really carried by the governments and the public research institutions? Thank you very much.
Thank you for that question. I think very, very important. So first I have a challenging part to my answer and then the rest of it. The challenging part to my answer, to be honest, is I think there's a lot of crap science happening in academia. The same way there was a lot of crap science happening in pharmaceutical industry. You just look into the literature. From time to time, there is truly an innovative idea. And then there are hundreds of thousands of publications that are just small increments and tweaks and reformulation of the same idea. Sometimes I think those are not worthwhile investments. Sometimes they do lead by chance to a great discovery. And therefore, there is an element of non-obvious or non-committal investment that can just that should just be there. But I do think that we need to raise the bar on our expectations, both from pharma R&D organization and from academic R&D organization. Now to your question, absolutely we're committed to collaborating and supporting the generation of knowledge that will help discovering and developing new medicine. Now, the area where we can be really impactful is in creating a lively and attractive, what I call, ecosystem for biotechnology companies to grow into. That's actually the intermediary between a scientific discovery and its first translation into something that could become a medicine in the area we work into. It's not our mission to be academic. Academia is there to generate knowledge. I would, and I do, advise a number of universities or other authorities that make those kind of decisions and advise them to raise the bar on how we invest in the generation of academic knowledge. But that's not the mission of industry. Our mission is actually to provide an opportunity for those ideas to become a product. And as I said, the translation between academia and pharmaceutical companies today is biotech companies, but you know, we're very amenable to creative idea to help extract that knowledge and translate it into a medicine. And by the way, we do it in a way where we don't own it. We invest, as you probably have seen, in a number of venture capital funds that invest in ideas outside of academia without owning them for us. So they are available to others and we'll compete with them to get them. There was a question here and then you, Alice.
Ara Darcy from London. May I also add my congratulations for a wonderful talk and an amazing turnaround of a great company, GSK. You mentioned great science, but I really wanted to add on that. One of the exciting opportunities coming up in science is stratified medicine and personalized medicine, which I have no doubt will significantly disrupt the business model of pharmaceutical companies. And I just wanted to get your thoughts and views. How would that change even further what you're doing at the moment as far as the pipeline of new discoveries, the cost? I mean, you said $1.8 billion per drug. No doubt that will be challenged in the future.
Absolutely. So again, thanks for that question. Very good question. Here is the way I'll answer it. We have decided to engage into rare disease drug discovery and development for that exact reason. Because in rare disease, particularly monogenic rare diseases, target validation, the biology validation in the clinic actually exists on day one. And the challenge I put to the organization is that it's impossible to fail to make a medicine. We know that that biology exists. So we need to go and discover the medicine and do it at a cost that's dramatically lower because we made the commitment we will never price our medicine for rare disease the same way they are priced today, which I find outrageous. And both myself and Andrew Witter, our CEO, talk about this all the time. So it is our mission to, if you wish, use drug discovery in rare diseases to help actually transform all our drug discovery, because a number of other biologies and biological pathways relevant to broader diseases can actually be validated in rare diseases, you know. And, you know, we already have in oncology, in some rare disease and in some vaccine for oncological use, they are already absolutely personalized medicines that are co-developed, the drug and the diagnostic test to elect patients into it. Now, I don't think it's going to be immediately true across the areas. I wish we had a marker in diabetes patients that can tell us, you know, here's what pathway you should go after and here's who's going to respond. The day we find that, of course, we'll pursue it, but today we're not able. So we still have to work on means and averages. Thank you. You so, let me know when we have to stop. Last question.
Okay. Alice Rubenstein, President of the New York Academy of Sciences. Moncef, because of the audience and our local setting, I mean, you've had some great questions and answers, but it crosses my mind. We have yourself, we have Magid Abugarbia here, who was a great medicinal chemist at Wyeth and doing drug discovery now at Temple. Adil Mahmoud, who was at Merck, who was a key figure. We think of Elias Serhuni. In the MENA region, at a certain generation, there were a lot of you guys that have risen very high up in industry and had extremely successful careers. And I'd like to have your reflection on the next generation, because role models, on the one hand, are necessary for the Islamic world and Muslim world, and particularly the Arab world. But also, is there an idea that you might have about the notion that we've been thinking about of trying to create a cohort, sort of a social network of young leaders of the future who could be identified, so that instead of you going to Shanghai only, or you going to Boston or New York, you could find across the MENA region or across the Islamic world really the exciting young talent in some kind of a scale?
Thank you, Alice, for that question. So here is the answer. If I was to go and ask out of the 10 largest pharma company, actually out of the 5 largest pharma company in the world, how many of their heads of R&D are from a Muslim or an Arab country, the overwhelming answer would be 0. The actual answer is 2 out of 5, right? Elias, Serhuni, and myself. Which is quite interesting and, frankly, surprising. And I think it's an opportunity we should take advantage of, because you're right. Actually, more than 50% of my time is spent around developing leaders and developing talent, which starts by identifying them, mentoring them, coaching them, challenging them, and then, at the same time, helping them run and creating the space around them for them to grow. And it takes a lot of time and effort. And, you know, the reason I'm here is exactly that, is to, you know, help achieve that in the Arab and the Muslim world, absolutely. Anyway, thank you very much, and next time.